The dry valleys in Antarctica are the largest patch of ice-free land on the continent. Still, they're host to some pretty epic features of ice. After spending a week at the frozen Lake Bonney Field Camp, I loaded my microscopes and sleeping gear into a helicopter destined for Lake Hoare, a field camp known for a different icy feature. Camp here at Lake Hoare is situated right next to a glacier, specifically Canada Glacier, which is this glacier that you can see behind me. It is epic, and I am about to go hike up it. I have never been glacier hiking before, so this is going to be an experience. You might be wondering why I'm going on a glacier hike for my very first time here in Antarctica. That seems a bit extreme, but I'm doing it all in the name of science, specifically microbes. There's these amazing structures on the glacier surface itself called crikenite holes, and these holes host all sorts of microbes. And so I'm going to be going up there with a team of scientists, and we're going to be sampling some of these crikenite holes, getting ice cores, and then getting, importantly, the dirt cores. There are so many awesome microbes that I've heard about that live on the glacier surface in these little holes. And so I am going to be putting myself through this glacier hike to actually go see where all these microbes live. I'm about halfway through the hike. The glacier is behind me. It's definitely been a lot of hiking, rock climbing, and then now I've got my crampons on and about to actually get onto this glacier, which is exciting. So I've now arrived on top of Canada Glacier. It's pretty incredible. You can actually see Mount Erebus behind me. And actually, it's my very first time on a glacier, and it's been awesome. I learned to take it slow up the hike, which means I am in much better condition than I was on some previous hikes. And now I'm gonna go check out some places where some microbes live up here on the glacier. Down to the sediment layer and just retrieve that sediment, where we will be just looking for the microbes.
So, and then we'll drill in. So you can choose whatever hole you want, Ariel. We'll just drill it for you.
Custom crikenite hole.
Yeah, exactly.
Whatever you want.
It's been a few hours since I got back from the hike up the Canada Glacier here at Lake Hoare. I'm very, very tired and sore, but I couldn't wait to actually see and look under the microscope to see actually what's in these crikenite holes. And you can see with these microscopes that I've got my Canon camera set up to them, hooked up with a Canon adapter to the microscope,
And then I'm getting live images on my laptop. So far I've seen ciliates and I've seen pink rotifers, which are a thing here on Canada Glacier apparently. And I even saw a tardigrade. Actually, I saw multiple tardigrades, but I was only able to successfully scoop one up so far. I never get tired looking at tardigrades. They're so cute. The other thing that's been really fascinating to look at is that all this spiral bacteria, I think is a type of cyanobacteria, and it just looks like party confetti exploded all over all of my petri dishes, which is pretty cool. It's really a thrill to actually go be in Antarctica, go up and hike on a glacier, sample it, and immediately see all of the life that lives here. This is what I love about Antarctica, is that it's really this polar oasis of life. So many people think that Antarctica doesn't have a whole lot of life in it. It's got a lot of life in it. So this is the main hut here at Lake Hoare. As you can see, there is a full kitchen behind me, complete with a microwave and a bunch of other stuff. This is where we all gather for meals, use the internet. It's a lot more buttoned up than at Lake Bonnie. We actually have drawers here and semi-modern appliances, so it's definitely a step up. But it's a nice cozy space, and as you can see, it's a space that can fit a lot of people around a table. So that gives it a nice feeling here. Today is my last full day here in the Dry Valleys, and I am really sad to be going. It is such a special place. I'm currently hiking around the glacier face of Canada Glacier here at Lake Hoare because it is so unbelievably gorgeous to actually be hiking around this glacier and kind of saying my last goodbyes to it. I now fully know why the Dry Valleys are so special to so many people and especially so many scientists. It really is a unique environment out here. And there's been so many aspects that have surprised me. Being here in the Dry Valleys really gives you a sense of just the nature of Antarctica and actually what Antarctica is like underneath all that ice. Ice that's often piling up like this glacier behind me. And so the Dry Valleys are great because you can actually see what the continent itself is like and get a feel for it and say that you've actually touched the continent, not just the snow and ice that Antarctica is famous for, but touched the ground itself, which is just awesome.
With all my gear loaded onto a helicopter again, I departed Lake Hoare to make my way back to the land of showers and indoor heating at McMurdo Station. We made one pit stop along the way to a mountain peak few people have ever been to, Mount Vosslips. Vosslips hosts the one repeater that provides limited internet to the Dry Valley field camps. It had been offline for days, and we were picking up the much appreciated repair crew. With the internet successfully repaired, we then departed the beauty of the Dry Valleys to go to my home away from home, McMurdo Station. On the next episode, I follow a team of researchers using a robot to explore mysteries under the sea ice. To catch all the episodes of my Antarctic expedition, be sure to subscribe to my YouTube channel. If you're interested in supporting this work, join my Patreon crew, where you can also, for a limited time, grab a signed print of the tardigrade I found living inside the glacier. Thanks to all my patrons, and a special shout out to the ones listed in the YouTube description below. You're wonderful. Also, thanks to the National Science Foundation Antarctic Artists and Writers Program, the San Francisco Microscopical Society, National Geographic, and the many Antarctic researchers, friends, and colleagues who helped so much along the way.